Paul Feinbaum here. In the South, we love football and Crystal. The Hot Off the Grill Crystal Burger is the perfect complement to any tailgate. Take a steamer pack of 24 Crystals to your tailgate. Why didn't I think of that? Plus, Crystal knows you love wings. Barbecue or buffalo wings, Crystal is the stop for all of your cravings this fall. Text Paul, that is P-A-U-L, to 37793, and Crystal will hook you up with two free Crystals. Nobody does football like the South, and nobody does tailgates like Crystal.
This is the best,
do you hear me?
Of the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
My man is up next.
Good afternoon, Paul.
Good afternoon.
It's a brisk afternoon in Capital City.
It is pretty brisk out there. It's wintertime. Well, it's winter.
I hate wintertime. I hate wintertime with a passion.
I do too. But you know the best part about winter? Weather. You know the best part about winter?
What's that?
Spring follows.
Well, that's the best part.
And then you don't have to deal with winter again for 9 months.
Well, and you know, the state of Alabama has kind of, with all this global warming and everything that Al Gore kept talking about, the state of Alabama has actually grown into full four seasons. It's almost 4 month periods of each. And yeah. Used to, we just had a brief winter, summer, and a very brief spring and fall, and short winter and summer.
Yeah, that's great.
Right now, it's not flip-flop weather. Listen, Paul, I've been hanging out with you for quite a while. I've been on several remotes and live things
with you. We've seen a lot of each other.
Yeah, and we have. And you know what? A lot of people know me through you. And I know a lot of people in Tuscaloosa. And I heard you say something yesterday, I think it was, that somebody sent you a picture, and you said you had seen that picture, but Jim said that wasn't him, and that was floating around 5 years ago. Well, you know what? I showed that picture to several people I do know in Tuscaloosa. Didn't say a word. They said, that's Jim from Tuscaloosa. That picture is Jim from Tuscaloosa working on that 1980s Chevrolet. And you know, Jim just, he's not the guy that, he just doesn't look like Jesse Owens. He doesn't look like Sandy Koufax or Minnesota Fats or any of them cats. Jim just looks like a guy in the backyard working on a car or trying to. And how do you go play golf where there's no place to play golf? But he does. He found a way. And you know what? He even gave you a score. He said 78. Mm-hmm. Just that casual, 78. But anyhow, Paul, that is picture Jim working on the car, and you know it, and I know it, and all of our friends know it, and guess what? Everybody in Tuscaloosa knows it, too. Now, you have a great weekend.
What do you want to bet Jim is the next caller?
Yeah, I didn't call for that reason. I'll get to that later. But that is a spiritually sick, lying, scumbag son. Look, you know, that's a lie. I don't have any picture out. I saw that picture. None of those pictures are me.
So Jim, somebody sent me that picture. Is that you?
No, it's not.
Okay.
I told you a year ago it wasn't me. Okay. I told you the stinking picture that Pat put in the studio 10 years ago was not me.
That was not.
But you know what,
we,
Pat,
we had a picture up
you,
in our old studio in Birmingham that I thought was you.
You really crossed the line today. What is this crap about taking cheap shots about me with regard to FBI? Why do you do that kind of crap?
That was just like a joke, man.
No, that's not a joke, you fool. You're an evil bitch. That's what you are. And I don't give a damn if I ever come back on your show again. You are a stinking evil bitch.
Hmm.
So are you.
Wow. Yeah, to give you some context, somebody called in and wanted to know whether, what was the first part of that? He said, is Jim either they're that good looking or not good. I don't remember what it was. Or does he not show up in public because he's on the FBI most wanted list? So it's obviously the latter. We all know Jim's on the most wanted list. And I would say, I don't know, let's say there's 500,000 people listening and watching. That's just for the sake of argument.
Yes.
Of that number, do you think anyone other than Jim thought I was being serious?
No.
So he called up and called me an evil bee. I've never been called that before. Hey, I've been called a million things in my career. But I've never been called an evil bee. Guys, I have to ask you this. I know you're busy in there, but is that
I don't want to sound naive, but that doesn't sound like a compliment.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't think we should dwell on, you know, if Jim's going to, you know, call names. Who calls names?
Right,
I
mean, we're still recovering in here.
That's something you do in the sixth or seventh grade. But I thought it was very ironic, Paul, that I did receive an email from someone in the FBI earlier this week. And I'm not kidding about that. Now, did it have anything to do with Jim from Tuscaloosa? I'm not willing to disclose that information.
I can't confirm or deny whether that picture, but I think that is his picture, though, Mr. Director.
Now, we'll put that picture on the air in a couple minutes.
Yeah, so. Let's go ahead and put that picture up.
Maybe we'll tweet it.
Yeah, tweet it. Facebook it. Snapchat it.
Instagram.
So, Jim, that was not a smart move. I mean, I have to tell you, friend. I'm not your friend. Don't attack. There used to be an old saying in the newspaper business: "Don't attack the people that buy ink by the barrel." That was a line that back in the old days. You don't upset the guys who control the printing press. That was then. You certainly don't upset the guys who can put your picture on the screen. The one that Iman says is you. And you say it's not. And you've also made Brams mad. I mean, Danny Cram. What did he call you again, Danny Crams Bram?
He called me Dullard Doofus Danny Crams, I believe. Yeah.
I mean, listen.
Which who's used? Nobody's used the word dullard since about 1943.
You know, what's your first name?
I know what it means.
Is your first name Brams or Danny?
Danny Daniel. Yeah.
I mean, I've worked here nearly 5 years. I've never heard anyone be ugly to Danny Dullard Crams Bram. Have you?
No.
John, have you?
No, total cheap shot from Jim.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I've heard trash about John, mainly coming from Randy.
I've trashed myself as well.
People trash me. That's fine. That's legal. That's kosher. But nobody trashes Danny Brams. It's like everybody's lovable friend.
Just a buddy.
Yeah. Hey, good old buddy, old pal. But to call me an evil bee, man.
That's low.
That hurt my feelings, I have to tell you. Thank goodness, though, he said it to me. And no one else was here.
He's lucky I can't get to him.
Yeah, because our friend from yesterday would have come across the table at him. She would not have tolerated that.
He had his eyes clawed out.
Yeah, he would have been dead. she would have just finished him off. I'm not as nice, but maybe I am too nice. But anyway, I'm going to get over it. I'm not going to think about it. I'm not going to let it bother me. Ray is up next. How are you, Ray?
Hey, Paul, how you doing?
Great, fantastic. Been a fan, maybe the best day of my life.
Well, I'm glad for that. I got a question for you. Nick Saban's one of the best SEC coaches ever.
Sure.
We agree. What do you think, or in the next 3 years, if he was to take any team in the SEC, could he take them to the SEC championship?
As great as he is, I think 3 years, there are a number of teams I think he could, not everyone.
Vanderbilt, could he do it?
I'm not sure what the roster they currently have.
Well, we're talking about today, but I'm in 3 years.
Yeah, and I'm sure not, I think some schools are not set up for that type of success.
Okay, but just a thought. Just wanted to share that with you.
Thank you very much. We are going to take a break. Now, I bet Matt Jones has never been called an evil bee. He will join us next. We're talking to our good friend from Kentucky. He will be with us when we come back. More of your phone calls as well.
You're listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
We welcome everyone back to the program. Radio folks are back with us. It's been a rather unusual program here. A lot of news. And there is some breaking news at this hour. Just in from the newsroom.
Hot off the press.
Breaking news. Jim from Tuscaloosa has been banned from the program. This is something that a lot of people have suggested for some time. But after he just dropped the evil beeline on the host of the Paul Feinbaum Show, the powers that be, the people in the other room who run this show.
And wear the mask.
Who wear the mask have decided that Jim is done. Sorry, Jim, you are done for the. You're done with the show. I'm not really a part of this decision. I just report the news as your friendly newscaster. Did you know this was coming?
No.
We did not know this was coming. But breaking news again: Jim from Tuscaloosa has been banned from the Feinbaum Show. More on the 6 o'clock news here. We'll get some reaction from the legal analyst of the program, Matt Jones, joining us from Kentucky Sports Radio. Matt, I know you're probably hearing this news as we are, but arguably one of the most famous callers in the history of this program. I don't know if you heard what he said a few minutes ago, but he called me an evil bee because I jokingly said that he was on the FBI's most wanted list.
Well, I'm sad to see him go in some ways because I've had some great battles with him. But, you know, since I was surprised he didn't spontaneously combust when Roy Moore lost. So the fact well, that he is banned is a tough day.
Yeah, I mean, he was a big supporter of Judge Moore. And, again, we don't talk politics on this program unless we're talking
to
you.
Well, who's we, Paul? I didn't sign that pledge, but yes.
Well, I said we being the Feinbaum Show, we are apolitical. On this program, we
I understand.
We didn't know anybody who was running in that race. Anyway, he is welcome to call your show, though. I guess isn't he?
I would love for him to. Yeah. I think you know. I always try to take your hand me down. So whatever, if he wants to come to KSR, we'd be glad to have him.
Well, how's everything going, Matt? We haven't talked to you in a long time.
Well, everything's great. You know, the basketball season is about to approach. The SEC is going to be better in basketball this year than in at least 15 years, I believe. And Kentucky football's in a bowl game, although everybody in the country believes Kentucky's going to lose by 1,000.
Yeah.
So things are actually pretty good here. And, of course, Rick Pitino and Tom Jurich both got fired. So I think things are pretty nice in Kentucky.
That's a double whammy for you, isn't it?
Well, I mean, in some ways, it's like what does Batman do when the Joker is gone, right? Like, it becomes, there's a part of me that wonders, am I going to miss them? I mean, they were such great foil for me for years. I mean, they were the living embodiment of the evil empire. And, like, you can't hate David Padgett, the current coach of, I mean, David Padgett's like 6'11 and nice, so what are you going to say? Now, good thing is they still got Bobby Petrino. Bobby Petrino might be the least likable human that exists, so that's good. But there's a part of me that will miss them, even though they should have been gone a long time ago.
Yeah, no doubt. That's a story that, as you know, it may not be old news in Kentucky, but, I mean, people are just so sick of Rick Pitino that they don't really care what happens to him, do they?
Yeah, you're right. And he was literally, this just came out, GQ magazine had their 10 least influential people of 2017, and they put Rick Pitino on it, which I think is, I mean, he was on there with, like, some really terrible characters. Pitino was right there. In some ways, it's a sad way to see that career end, because, I mean, you remember Rick Pitino.
Oh, my goodness.
Would you have ever imagined the Rick Pitino with the Knicks and Kentucky?
No.
That this would be how it would end. You just would have never imagined.
No, I mean, honestly, Matt, if he called in right now, I wouldn't take his call. I mean, he's just not that relevant.
The banned list is Jim from Tuscaloosa. Yeah, I
hate to tell you, I would probably go to Jim first, even though he's banned.
Wow, that is something else. Jim didn't even make the least influential list.
Let me ask you, though, speaking about not being very influential, and I don't want to rain on his parade because, you know, some will look from a distance and go, hey, 7-5, that's progress. But this Kentucky season, Matt, it just didn't end well. And if this bowl game goes like many think it will, I don't know what to say about this year. Do you?
Well, it's tough because on the surface, listen, you know how many years in the last 30 Kentucky's had a better record than 7-5? One.
Yeah, one.
One time. So on one level, I can understand, and I've heard Stoops sort of hint this a little bit. Look, we've had back-to-back 7-5 years. That's happened twice in the last 35 years. So why aren't people happy? But I think a lot of it is there'll never be a Kentucky football schedule easier than this one. The SEC East was a disaster, and they played Mississippi State and Ole Miss on the other side. You couldn't have asked for a better schedule. And they lost to Florida for the 32nd straight time, a game they should have won. So, and they finished the year getting blown out by Louisville. So I think that makes it tough. Now, on the counter to that, I would say, though, Kentucky continues to make strides forward. You remember what the program was like when Mark Stoops got there. They were awful. Neil Brown was the offensive coordinator at the time. And he told me when he took the job, it was the worst talent he had seen in a Division I, five major conference team. And I don't think that's wrong. And now, you know, they're the top 20 in next year's recruiting class. They just got a quarterback commitment over Florida and Nebraska. So there's a lot of positives, but you're right. There's a sense amongst fans that it was a year that they let stuff go.
Overall, let me get some of your thoughts about this league. You mentioned how bad the East was. I mean, there have been so many coaching changes. Everyone has had opinions. I'm sure the one that has interested you the most is the one in Knoxville.
Oh, boy, that's great.
From start to finish, a lot of people seem to think that Jeremy Pruitt was a very good choice by Philip Fulmer. Now, I don't know what scale they're grading that on, maybe based on the disaster that preceded it, But I'm really curious from the beginning to the end, your thoughts on this unbelievable.
Here's what I would say about Jeremy Pruitt. Jeremy Pruitt would have been a heck of a hire at Kentucky, right? Because that's the kind of coach Kentucky usually gets. They go to a program that's had a lot of success, and they go and hire one of their coordinators, and they hope it works out. That's what they did with Mark Stoops at Florida State. Tennessee, I always thought, was better than them. I mean, I just did, and I know Tennessee fans did. Now, that doesn't mean he won't have success. Lots of great coaches come through that pipeline, and he might end up being great. But what surprised me about that coaching search is that Tennessee basically has now become in the tier of programs that has to go hire somebody and hope, right? That is not what Tennessee used to be. Alabama, LSU, Florida – they don't have to go hire somebody and hope. They go hire somebody they know is good and hope they become great. Tennessee now finds itself hiring the kind of coaches Kentucky hires. Hire a coordinator and hope. And now look, I think he might be wonderful, but that was surprising to me to watch that develop, even though I've kind of been hitting at it for a while. I think what you saw in these coaching searches is you saw the tiers of programs in the SEC. To me, there are six jobs that they get what they want. Alabama, Auburn, LSU, Florida, Texas A&M, and then probably Georgia. And Tennessee thinks it's one of those teams, but they're not, and this coaching search showed it.
Talking to Matt Jones, and Matt, I want to ask you, as someone who is, you know, hosts a radio show that it really represents the people of the Commonwealth. What is your thought on a lot of Tennessee fans, even some well-known colleagues of ours who seem to be gleeful in taking credit for having run off Greg Schiano?
I think it was embarrassing. I mean, I think that was one of the more embarrassing couple days I've ever seen. I mean, they're gleeful about it, but they have totally ruined that man's reputation on a national level in a way that will be hard for him to overcome. For what purpose? Now, I know a lot of them are going to say, well, he may have done this or known this at Penn State, and maybe he did, but that is far from clear, far from clear. And I believe that for 80% of those people, it didn't matter. They did not want him to be the coach because they did not think he was a good enough coach. And thus, they found something to attach on, and what happened next sort of was irrelevant to them. And I think it is really disgraceful. Now, of course, we might find out one day that Schiano knew a lot more about all the stuff at Penn State, and then fans might go, we'll see. But the thing is, they didn't know that at the time. They were taking something, and what they were mad about is that Schiano's last name was not Gruden. That's what they were mad about. And now they get Jeremy Pruitt. And again, maybe he'll be great. But what do we know about Jeremy Pruitt to say that he'll certainly be better than Greg Schiano was? Based on what? So you essentially ruin a man's reputation, probably are going to cost your school quite a bit of money if he sues, to do what? To get a guy that might be better, might be worse. I'm not sure that was the proudest day for the Tennessee fan base.
And not only that, like it or not, the athletic director gets fired 5 days later because he wants to bring in Mike Leach in the aftermath of this debacle. I mean,
who would have been good, by the way?
Okay, I'm curious.
Mike Leach would have been good. I think Mike Leach would have actually had a lot of success. And listen, Philip Fulmer seems like a great guy. One of my colleagues is really good friends with him up here, and I'm sure he's wonderful, and he's done a lot for that program. But is the way to move Tennessee football forward to where you're, like, headed towards modern success to bring in Philip Fulmer? I mean, he's a wonderful dude, I'm sure, but really? Like, do you think all across America the sexy Tennessee football fan is brand is back because Philip Fulmer's back involved? Mike Leach would have been fun. I will tell you this. Here's how I judge coaching hires of my rival. Do they scare me? And when I heard they were getting Mike Leach, they scared me because I thought Tennessee's going to beat Kentucky 55-10 for the next 5 years. I don't feel that way about Jeremy Pruitt. So in my mind, I'm glad they hired Pruitt instead of Leach.
Before you go, let's get a basketball update. We'll be spending plenty of time in the winter months talking to you about that. But how are the Cats looking? And I think they're playing, what, Northwestern this weekend?
No, they play Virginia Tech, who's actually
Virginia
pretty
Tech.
Good.
Okay.
I think the basketball team, this weekend's game will tell us a lot. Virginia Tech leads the nation in scoring.
Shows you how much I follow Kentucky football. I got the bowl game confused with the basketball
team. Yes, they play Northwestern in the bowl game.
No big deal. Same school, different sport.
Same amount of dorky sports journalists that went there, just different sport. We'll know a lot more about Kentucky basketball after this weekend. I think they win, but Virginia Tech scores a lot.
Okay.
The next three games for Kentucky, Virginia Tech, UCLA, Louisville. You'll know a lot more about Kentucky at the end of that stretch.
What's that Louisville game going to be like?
It'll be weird because the bowl game's the same day.
I
actually think, Paul, this would surprise you, but I've talked to a lot of fans, and more people are going to the bowl game than the basketball game.
That's interesting.
And it's because Rick's gone.
Yeah, it's hard to really hate Louisville as much, isn't it?
Yeah, they do. It's hard to hate them as much because this team is weird. They got likable guys, and David Padgett's a lame duck coach. So people are like, well, we can't go boo this kid who all this was going on. So I actually think, bizarrely, it'll be one of the least, like, exciting Kentucky-Louisville games ever. Although once they hire somebody new next year, it'll get right back to where it is.
So what's the day of that game?
It's the 29th. So Kentucky plays Louisville at 1 in basketball.
Is that next Friday?
It's a Friday.
Yeah.
And they play at 1 in basketball on CBS. And then at 4:30 on ESPN in the bowl game against Northwestern in Nashville. So, like, it is a huge day. That is I will say, a kind of make-or-break UK fan day. If you beat Louisville and then win the bowl game, that's a heck of a day. But if you lost both those games, I'm not sure Kentucky fans would have much worse of a day possible.
So, as the be-all sports figure in that state, where will you be that day?
I'm going to the bowl game. I mean, look, Kentucky in my lifetime has only been to like 6 bowl games, so I'm going to it when it happens. They'll play Louisville again next year. Who knows when the bowl games come?
So that's a week from today, Louisville and Kentucky.
No. 2 weeks. Two weeks.
Why?
29th. Remember, there's a little holiday called Christmas between now and then.
I am sorry.
Liberals have a war on Christmas.
You're right.
We celebrate it here in Kentucky, and don't you forget it.
Can we buy a calendar in here so I can – I'm trying – you think I'm trying to rush through Christmas? Is that what I'm doing?
No, I know how it is. It's you secular liberals trying to end Christmas. I know how it is.
Hey, when are you running for the Senate?
Well, they got to have a race first. But, you know, if a Jones can win in Alabama, Paul.
are you related to that Jones is my question.
I'm not. I will say, here's the thing about Doug Jones, and I'll shut up. When he started talking and he went, golly, I never thought I'd be here. I was like, well, that guy did not think he would be here. That's true.
When you saw the headline, though, Senator Jones, you saw that in the Montgomery Advertiser, Senator Jones, Democrat, you had to start thinking, though, didn't you?
I was sitting there thinking, did I wake up in Mobile one day and not realize I was there?
By the way, when is McConnell's seat open?
It's 2020, but I mean, not that I've been looking or anything.
No. Hey, by the way, Trump may send you a donation if you run against McConnell.
Hey, listen, we take on all comers. I can I have a Make Kentucky Bowl Eligible Again hat, and so we can transfer that around into something else if we need to.
The next time we talk, we'll talk about Rand Paul and all that's going on with him. I'm sure that's been
a great story that was, wasn't it? Have you ever gotten in a fight with somebody about their yard work?
No, that has not happened in my life.
By the way, have you ever mowed your yard? That's my question.
Yes, I have. I have.
When's the last time you mowed your yard?
Senator, I can't recall that question right now.
Well, thanks.
I'll talk to the staff, and we'll provide you with a written response to that as soon as we're finished with this hearing. Matt, thanks for the call. We always enjoy talking.
Thank you.
Good to talk to you.
Bye-bye.
Matt Jones, always entertaining. And we will come back. You can tell we're a little sluggish today. We're getting dates wrong, bold matchups wrong. We've been called an evil bee. I have not been the same since then. I'm sorry. I just can't think straight. I'm calling in sick the rest of the day. Hope you enjoy the rest of your afternoon. Peter Burns will be joining us shortly.
You're listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
You're not worth a flip.
Computer, execute 12.4p operation.
Optimizing algorithm. Running encryption packet alpha. Night, night. Oh, I don't feel so good.
What? What is it, computer?
Is it hot in here? It feels hot in here. I feel a little clammy. I should lie down or something.
A computer with a virus? Surprising. What's not surprising? How much you could save by switching to GEICO.
Those oysters Rockefeller were a mistake.
GEICO. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more.
You're listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
We haven't talked to this next guest in a long time. He's with the Chicago Tribune, Teddy Greenstein. Always a great sport, entertaining. And, Teddy, hope the season has
Paul,
been good
I'm
to you. How are you?
Paul, I'm awesome, buddy. How are you?
We are doing great. We talked to you, I think, as the season was unfolding and once or twice since then. But I want to start with your reaction. Certainly the Big Ten had its moments this year. But how bitter a pill was it for Ohio State not to get in the playoff?
You know, I think Ohio State fans were not as angry as Alabama fans would have been if the Crimson Tide had been snubbed. Because I think Ohio State fans look at it and they say, yeah, we did lose twice badly. You know, I think they basically gave up hope after that Iowa game. I mean, if you give up 55 points as a fan base, I think you're saying, okay, this is probably not our year. You know, then a couple things happened, and there were some upsets to give them, you know, to make them feel like, all right, maybe this is going to happen. But I think they also saw in the Big Ten championship game, they didn't dominate. It wasn't 59-0 like it had been a few years earlier under, you know, with Cardale Jones, a quarterback. So I think they were pretty realistic. The only thing that was messed up in their minds is, you know, they were told a week earlier by Kirby Hokut, hey, there's a very little gap here between 5 and 8. And they've always been told that conference titles mean a lot. So I think they kind of just felt like, wait a second, do conference titles mean a lot or nothing? Because it feels like the goalposts were moved.
You know, I agree with you on that. I thought that that was fairly dishonest of the committee to say that. And then when they came back on that Sunday, their answer just made no sense whatsoever.
They just make it up. You know, you just make it up if you want to justify it. I mean, my take after the Big Ten title game had been Ohio State will get the call, but Alabama should get the call. You know, I'm a guy who really values the regular season, and you couldn't just pretend that Ohio State didn't lose, you know, at home to Oklahoma and get destroyed at Iowa. So I really thought Alabama deserved to be there. But based on what we've known from the previous few years, since 2014, I thought Ohio State was going to get the call. I also thought that just geographically, you know, you'd probably want to include the Midwest rather than not. But the committee went for Alabama, and, hey, they're going to put up a much better fight against Clemson than Ohio State would.
Yeah, you know, and that's what I heard from even as you did and have from Ohio State fans. When it got right down to it, it was hard to argue. And I'm curious because you cover this league, and I've always thought it was a really good league, but in that game, it almost seemed like that game was a setback, the game against Wisconsin.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree, Paul. It wasn't a great game. I mean, there were some weird aspects to it. Obviously, Wisconsin's defense had been amazing all season, and then they allow 5 plays of 50-plus yards. Now, when you hear that Ohio State has 5 plays of 50-plus, you think it's probably going to be a blowout, and yet there it is, 27-21. Wisconsin is driving late in the game, and if not for a holding penalty that could have been nullified by what looked like a pass interference by Ohio State, you know, they would have been offsetting penalties. Wisconsin's got a pretty good chance to go down and win the game despite not playing all that great. So the game was kind of blah. I don't think either team looked really that strong, and I think that's why Ohio State fans can, you know, swallow the fact that they're not in the playoff.
Teddy, let me ask you about the playoffs. So you follow college football with a front row seat. Let me start with Alabama. Hard to get a handle on this team. Supposedly going to be a lot better with players coming back. But yep. take a look at that game against Clemson for us.
Well, I mean, how can you not be unbelievably impressed with Clemson? I mean, to lose Deshaun Watson and still be spectacular, other than, you know, one night at Syracuse, you know, I got to think that Clemson's the team. But I'm going to be honest, I didn't see Alabama play a ton this year. I was smoking four when they were playing Auburn, so I'm not going to pretend to be an expert on that team. But I do think also Alabama made a good point. Those fans were there saying, wait a second, I mean, if you're going to start talking about, you know, giving a break to teams when they had injured players, what about our linebackers? And I think that's that's completely valid in part, and should have been part of why, you know, they got that number four seed.
And on the other side, we have Oklahoma and Georgia. What do you think gives in that game?
Yeah, I mean, I saw Georgia play at Notre Dame, and those defensive ends were just spectacular. You know, against an offensive line of Notre Dame's, we felt like they have at least two first-round picks, if not top 20 picks. And Georgia certainly had some momentum. That said, that Oklahoma offense is unstoppable, and unless the Jinx gets to the quarterback, I think Oklahoma's going to do it there.
Talking to Teddy about the college football season. Teddy, the bowl games, they start tomorrow, and you know, I know that every team and every fan can find something that they like, but
right.
But I'm anxious to find something you like, as opposed to maybe changing the format a little bit or adding teams to the playoff.
Well, I mean, what I like is, you know, we've got bowl mania, we've got bowl pools. I mean, they're like, you know, so many different ways to, you know, to wager and have fun with these games that it's funny. I mean, last week Army-Navy was absolutely spectacular, but it was the only game on the weekend, and you feel like, wait a second, where's the rest of my football? So a lot of these games won't be interesting. There'll be, you know, 27 people in the crowd for some of them, but just having football on TV and having them be part of a pool, I think, you know, that's pretty exciting for a lot of people.
In the end, I mentioned the playoffs. If you had to pick a winner today, would you go with Clemson, or do you have somebody else in mind?
Oh, it would be Clemson or Oklahoma. You know, I'd like to see those semifinal games first before I really make a pick. But if I had to, I would say Clemson right now.
And you would go with Oklahoma in the other game?
I would, exactly, with Baker, yes.
Well, we knew we could count on you for SEC bias.
Except I know some of your listeners will be disappointed that I'm not lobbying for, you know, a two-loss Ohio State to get that fourth spot in the playoffs.
Yeah,
no chance, man.
We held off because I had a feeling, knowing you, you're a pragmatist, you would probably not be that upset. We just had Matt Jones on. He was talking about Kentucky, obviously, taking on Northwestern, a school near and dear to your heart. You're in Chicago. Is there? Yeah, I mean, I'm really curious what you think about the Northwestern season as we approach that game.
Yeah, and I was up in Evanston yesterday, and I'll be at that. I'll be in Nashville for the Music City, so extremely excited for a couple days there. But here's what I can tell you, and I think you'll get a kick out of this. Last year, you might recall that Danny Cannell put a 40 on Pittsburgh to beat Northwestern at Yankee Stadium in the Pinstripe Bowl. I didn't really know about it, sorry, Danny, until after the game when Fitz and all the players made a huge deal about it and said that it had motivated them throughout bowl prep. Now we go to this year. Northwestern is favored by more than 7. I don't think Northwestern's ever been favored by a bowl game in program history. And they're wary of the same thing happening. In fact, they've heard of commentators now putting a 40 on Northwestern. So I can promise you, the Wildcats of Evanston are absolutely wary of Kentucky in terms of really good athletes, really good skill guys, Benny Snell, Steven Johnson. And they are, you know, they don't want to have it flipped to them. They don't want Kentucky all of a sudden to be motivated by everyone telling them they don't have a chance or they should just be happy to be there. Northwestern is determined to play well in this game.
Enjoy the Music City experience. Teddy, always great to catch you up. Hope to see you soon.
Thanks, Paul. Have a great one, man. Take care.
You got great writer Teddy Greenstein. Well, joining us here from the Chicago Tribune. We are going to take a break. We've been pretty busy with phone callers and guests. A couple of callers in particular have owned the day or ruined the day. Take your pick. We are coming back with more.
You're listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
You're not worth a flip.
Welcome back to the program. We mentioned that earlier today, during our first hour, Laura and I had a chance to check in with the very new, just introduced last week, coach at the University of Arkansas, Chad Morris.
Thank you for the opportunity to be the next head football coach at the University of Arkansas. I promise you, the more you get to know me, I won't let you down. Our staff won't let you down. We want to win. Make no mistake about it. We're here to win. We want to win. We want to win championships. The one thing you'll never have to do is you'll never have to tell me go. You may have to tell me whoa, but you won't ever have to tell me go.
And we welcome you back. We've been listening to Coach Morris at his introductory press conference, and he seems like he got the Woo-Pig Suey down pretty well.
You got to get the Woo-Pig Suey down. He does look good. We'll ask him about his technique in just a moment. But, Paul, getting piggy with it. Here's what Arkansas has. This is what he's inheriting. Finished 4-8, last place in the SEC West, 1-7 in the SEC. Tough year, certainly. And the notable 2018 returnees, I think this is what you really look at. You know, the Allen era is over. Brandon Allen and Austin Allen no longer there. So quarterback Cole Kelly, certainly a big body at the QB position, needs some work in some areas, but he will be coming back, as well as defensive end McTelvin Ajeem. So good stuff there.
Coach, thanks for being with us. I watched your press conference live, and you nailed pretty much everything. I'm most interested in how you got the Woo-Pig Suey down on such short notice.
Well, actually, my wife the night before YouTubed it, and we had to practice in Dallas in our living room before we flew up.
Oh my goodness!
Wait, yeah. I'm imagining just the visual there. You two in the living room, just doing Woo-Pig in the living room. I'm sure that was fun. Did you critique each other and kind of say, hey, your form's a little off?
Well, no, but we did know this. We knew, of course, my son Chandler, he was like, hey, look, we can't mess this up. We can't get off on the wrong foot right off. And I said, absolutely. So let's get it out. Let's practice right now.
Coach, I have to tell you something. I was out there a couple of years ago, and they were going to ask me to do it, I think, on our set. I did the exact same thing, and I still screwed it up. So obviously that's why you're the head coach, and I'm watching.
You know, Paul sometimes messes those things up that are very important to schools. But, Coach, we just saw the graphic there of what's coming back for you, what you're inheriting there at Arkansas. And I know it's been a whirlwind for you, but have you had a chance to see what's on this team a little bit and kind of, you know, look at the state of the program?
Well, you know, what's kind of ironic about this is that throughout the course of the season, sitting in a hotel room getting ready to go and play our games, Arkansas actually came on a couple, two or three times. And, just from afar watching it and just kind of evaluating and just watching the schemes on both sides of the ball. But as far as just, you know, looking at the roster, finding out what's coming back, I've got an idea. But a little bit more with this early signing period, which has been absolutely crazy. I hadn't had a chance to do anything but drink a lot of Red Bull and try to stay on the run as much as I can. But that's something that we'll come back in on Sunday night and Monday and really get into our roster deep.
How many Red Bulls a day, Coach?
Well, I'm rolling pretty good right now.
That's what we call a non-answer.
Yeah, we'll send
industry.
You a case in the mail
but,
soon.
But I do want to ask you about that because we just got through talking about the early signing period, and it's hard to figure out from a distance what's it been like up close.
Well, you know, it's at the time, I think everybody thought it was a good idea. But what we're finding out, and especially with the coaching changes right now, is, you know, you're having to get into contact periods. They hired me on Thursday. I've basically been here 8 days. You're trying to get into people's living rooms. You're trying to get into schools with the guys that are committed to hang on to the commits, gather guys, make sure that, look, give me a chance to build a relationship. You're trying to build a two-year relationship in about 20 minutes, and that's impossible. And and you go into these schools, and a lot of these kids right now are in final exams. And so, you know, how many times these kids are being pulled out of class right here in a key time for them, It's been very difficult. I didn't see it in this scope, but it has been very challenging.
Hmm. Yeah, I think we don't even know exactly yet what some of the challenges could end up being. You're bringing up a lot of them. So, Coach, I'm just curious about this, and you may not even know. Do you expect more of your class to sign early, or do you expect a lot of them or a good portion to wait until February?
I think what you're going to find is probably about 50-50. I think you've got some guys that have been committed to the University of Arkansas, and with the coaching change, they're still committed, but they want to build that relationship and make sure it's the right fit for them. And then you got some that we've had existing relationships with, maybe that they've got a coach that knew me from a prior relationship along the way that kind of can vouch to the type of person I am and the staff we're going to bring in that are ready to go on Wednesday. So the way it's looking right now, I'm seeing about 50-50, and that's okay, because if you're unsure, we want to have a chance to build a relationship with you and just give us a chance through the month of January.
And, Coach, you just mentioned the staff, and I think I know how you're going to try to answer this, but how difficult is that with some of the people that you may be interested in bowl games and maybe playing in bigger games than that?
Yeah, it's been really, really tough. Really tough, Paul, on that when you start looking at it, because, you know, they've got obligations to their other university that they're at right now, and they're in a signing period and a signing class time that they don't want to do anything to disrupt there. That's been very difficult. And so, you know, while we've got a really, really strong idea of what my staff is going to look like, you're not ready to announce anything and can't announce anything right now until some of these games get out of way, and definitely until after the 20th gets here.
Coach, what would you like to make this Arkansas team look like? I know that's a broad question, but just with what you're bringing over from SMU, what do you think is realistic very early there?
Well, a couple of things, and that's a great question, because you know, one of the things that we talked about during the process of the interview, and we interviewed it several times, you know, I got to Clemson when they were coming off a 6-7 season. And the dynamics of that program and Coach Sweeney being a young head coach at that time, the vision that he had in place for that program, the dynamics of both of those programs, that this program and Clemson, are very similar. Arkansas looks very similar to what Clemson looked like some 7 years ago. And so, you know, with the vision and the values that we're going to put in place, and the recruiting and our networking throughout the state of Arkansas down into Texas and around our bordering states to recruit high level players, very similar. So you know, one of the things that I would say about this program, it is a great time. It's a great fit for me being the head coach here. And, you know, you would want to get this program back to where it's been several years ago, and winning championships and eventually build it into a prominent week in and week out top five, top two program in the country.
Coach, I know it's been crazy. We really appreciate you making a few minutes for us, and we really do hope to get to know you better in the near future. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Coach.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Appreciate y'all. Thank you.
Oh, what a pleasure. Very interesting conversation there with Coach Morrison. I have to admire him. He just shot straight. I mean, he said this is a mess.
Yeah.
With his early signing
and he also said that a lot of people thought it would be a good thing, but we didn't necessarily predict some of this. A good point, too, from Coach Morris about how a lot of these high school kids are in exams right now. And time is winding down in this part of the year for them. They're about to head into holiday breaks and all that. I mean, I just wonder how quickly things could be changed with it if there were change in the future, if coaches came together and said, hey, this didn't really work. But, you know, it also remains to be seen how many do end up signing early, and that will factor in as well.
That was earlier today. We appreciate you watching it. Very interesting, Coach. Very interesting comments from Coach Morris. So that is where we are right now. We are going to continue with your phone calls at 855-242-7285. A long way to go before we say goodnight on what has been an eventful Friday afternoon. Stick around.
You're listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
Put a little cherry on the top.
You're listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast.
There is some, I don't know if I hear the music or not, but there is a breaking news. Again, let me repeat this to our audience. A couple of hours ago, there was an incident on the show that Jim from Tuscaloosa called in and called me an evil bee. and then twice. And then the powers that be decided that he should be banned, and I really had no objection to it. I didn't really get in the way, and that's exactly what happened. So he has been banned. We tried to raise a little money. We got up to, what, $678.78. That wasn't to bring him back. I think he misinterpreted mm-hmm. that. But that was to get him a little help. Anyway, developing story here, breaking news. Jim from Tuscaloosa banned, and we have been the first network to be able to reach out to Laura Rutledge. We have been able to track her down. So we welcome Laura Rutledge to our program for her first public comments on this simply epic event. Laura, thanks very much for joining us. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Paul. And yeah, I mean, truly historic day here. I tell you what, I heard when the news was broken, I immediately got a call from our bosses. They instructed me to hop on a plane, fly to Tuscaloosa. I am here now in Tuscaloosa reporting live on Jim and his suspension and his banning. There's been a little bit of discrepancy from his camp on whether or not it's a suspension or a banning. I have informed him that he has been banned, and that led to me being kidnapped and taken to the Tuscaloosa Country Club, where I am currently trying to escape. If anyone wants to come here and help me out, I have laid eyes on Jim. He doesn't look like what I expected, and we're all just trying to figure out where to go from here. But Paul, I tell you what, I will never forget this day for the main reason of the fact that I have learned that the Tuscaloosa Country Club still has a few tables in here, although there are lots of cobwebs at this establishment here.
Yeah, and Laura, I am sorry about the kidnapping. I really am, but we have lawyers and security. We'll work on that as soon as we get you off the air. But the genesis of this is that somebody published a picture of Jim, and that's how he called in and was very upset, and then the whole diatribe started. So are you currently at – I'm not much of doing breaking news, so I apologize for all the stumbling around, but are you currently at the site of the country club?
I'm at the site, and I've been able to get myself into a separate room because I was trying to escape, but the people from Ted Williams' camp are here as well. And they're doing everything they can to
rectify the
situation.
Cryogenics people, you mean, or the Red Sox?
They're the Red Sox, okay. And there's a Ted Williams fund that's been put in place for Jim because of the legacy of Ted Williams that he so valiantly carries on in his life. And so the Red Sox are willing to make at least an effort here financially to get him back in the mix here. But, you know, as inquiring minds are wondering, you know, how long will this ban last? And what I found from my reporting here on the ground and just in polling a few people close to the situation, Paul, I mean, people think that this ban is going to be very serious and that it will last for quite some time, although there are a few that will remain nameless that are already starting a petition. I wonder what our callers, you know, truly will think about that and in what way they will look at that petition. But, yeah, the Ted Williams people, I see Jim's coming my way, guys. I might have to call you back. I'm going to try to run away, though, Paul, just in case he might come over here, but I'm not sure.
Well, Laura, I mean, what's so interesting is, I mean, you're just such a great reporter, but I have to ask you as the co-host of the show to put that hat on for a second. I know I'm confusing and blurring the lines here between reporting and opinion, but what do you think should happen? Because I mean, I was blindsided by the evil beeline today, and
you know, Paul, I was blindsided too because usually Jim is more creative with his name calling. Do you remember the time where he called me Bimby because he said that was short for Bimbo, even though Bimby and Bimbo are the same amount of letters in a word? And so I really thought, you know, and some of the things that he's called Daniel Bramlett today on the show are really shocking. But yeah, Evil B was not where I thought he would go with you. And that's really what truly got me. But you know what I think we've seen today is just the overwhelming support of this ban. I mean, in previous bans, Paul, has the support been this strong?
Yeah, one thing that I didn't realize, and Danny Crammy Brams, whatever his name is in the other room, said this, but he said that Jim apparently has confiscated a couple of fake accounts, and those are the only support that he's getting. And we're monitoring it right now, our social media team, which includes Randy.
Yeah, we have a social media team. Yeah.
Well, you know,
can they come rescue me from the Tuscaloosa country?
I have called. I tried to call the Alabama football complex, but nobody answered the phone.
They're too busy with early signing day.
Yeah, exactly. So, Laura, I mean, I hate to ask you to try to fend for, even though I know you can, to fend for yourself for the time being while we try to get some help over there. But
there were some leftover pizza crusts from the pizza party that happened here the other day. So,
well, I know you're nowhere near Twitter, but you've already been attacked by Jim, so I just want you to know that.
Oh no, well, that's just on the day's work, though. It wouldn't be a normal day if I didn't get something from Jim telling me, you know, how wonderful I am, aka attacking me. But I tell you what, I mean, this is truly groundbreaking, Paul. And I think on a day where there wasn't a lot of news.
No.
I mean, look at this. I mean, have you noticed? I mean, President Trump has tweeted about this. We've seen many famous people who are weighing in on all of this news and just what's happened on your show. And my goodness, I mean, way to just shake it up today.
Yeah, John Hayes, what did you just say? You said Saban is about to address the situation? Yeah,
Nick Saban, Paul, is scheduled to address the media at 7 o'clock. We do not know if he will address this specific situation, but we will monitor what he says to the media in Tuscaloosa tonight.
Yeah,
I mean, I feel sure, guys, he's been advised not to comment, but he just may have to say something. It's just that serious. A lot of times Coach Saban will say he's not watching and not paying attention. Guarantee you he didn't miss this.
Oh, Laura, you know, everyone's watching right now.
As they should be.
Well, I don't want to be too. I mean, you're certainly a big girl, but I am concerned. Randy and I are both concerned about your safety.
Yeah. By the way, I'm good. I'm putting my feet up here. I do stand by my pledge. I was the mystery pledge. I know a lot of people were concerned about who that was. Mystery pledge of $200 in the support of Jim.
Let me make sure, because there were some sirens. So you just acknowledged that you were the mystery donor.
I'm the mystery donor, yeah. Pledging $200 for the support of helping Jim, and because truly that's what we're about. You know, Paul, we're a family. We want to help everybody, and I'm going to give $200. And frankly, I mean, let's be real. I make the least amount of money of anybody on that show. So my $200 really goes a long way. That's hard for me to.
By the way, there is, I will keep silent on this, but there's a person in the other room who actually is taking exception to what you said.
Oh well, is that Daniel Bramlett who's paying 78 cents?
It was actually Hayes.
Hayes is sitting on a big fat stack of cash. So I don't. That's what happens when you're a Big Ten guy.
Yeah, but the good news is after all of this, we may all get raises, so that may change.
We're all going to be on the Ellen DeGeneres show tomorrow.
We are, yeah, we will. Yeah. We will.
Well, Laura, I'm already committed.
Are you safe? Okay, I mean, I don't.
I've done a few live reports coming up on CNN and Fox and NBC and CBS. So just everybody tune in. I'm going to be reporting live on this situation with much more to come, many more details coming your way.
As they say on Thursday night, Laura Rutledge down on the field. Laura, please let us know your location. Your mom actually just texted me. Make sure you're okay. But I shouldn't have said that. Thank you.
My mom has your number? What?
We exchanged numbers while you were hosting SEC Nation a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, thanks for telling me. Wow. What else are you doing behind my back anyway?
I'll tell you some other time. Quite a bit, actually. So, Laura Rutledge, live report. Laura, we will talk to you very soon. And again, be safe. Be careful.
Sounds good, guys. Yeah, no, thank you. Appreciate it.
That was such a great report by Laura. Unfortunately, I feel badly for her from this regard now that she's taking some of the shrapnel from Jim. But she knew that anyway going in, and she made it clear she had also offered $200. I tried to protect her. She's a fighter. We'll be back. 30 minutes to go. Unless we can we extend the show to later? Is there anything on after us?
Nothing.
Okay.
Thank you for listening to the Paul Feinbaum Show podcast. The Paul Feinbaum Show airs weekdays on the SEC Network beginning at 3 Eastern.